By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority? Jesus said to them, I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another. If we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said the first. And Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of heaven ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, good, you guys are awake. All right, let me ask you, have you ever done this? Your parents have told you that you need to clean your room. That's my room today, see? You have to clean your room before you go out and play. How many of you have been told to do that? Okay. Now, how many of you have thought, I really want to go out to play, I'm going to have a good time, so I'm just going to take everything and sweep it under my bed and not clean it? How many of you have been caught for doing this? Me too. So one of your parents probably found out what you did, right? And when you came back in, or maybe while you were playing, they shouted, hey! Come back home. And when you got home, they said, did you clean your room? And you went, uh-huh. And then they said, really? Did you clean your room? And you had to go, no, I just pushed it under my bed, right? The gospel lesson today is Jesus telling us that it's very important, not just with earthly things like cleaning our room, but also when it comes, especially when it comes to our hearts and our faith and our spirit and what Jesus tells us to do, that we don't just say, yeah, I'll do it, and then sweep it under the bed, but we do what we say. We mean what we say. That was the point Jesus was making. That's why he said that the son who changed his mind and went back and did it was the one that showed what the kingdom of heaven is all about. So that's Jesus' gift and point to us today. That every day we live in Jesus, when we say we're going to do something, when it comes to loving God, we do it. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for doing what you say for me. Bless me and help me to mean what I say when it comes to faith and loving you. In Jesus' name. Thank you very much. You guys can quietly go to your classrooms for your Sunday school lessons. As I was driving to the church one day this past week, I was getting on the Sacramento Parkway, and I got behind a car. that had the license plate, I'm great. I am space GR number 8T. And I was just flabbergasted. And I was so stunned that somebody would actually have the courage to announce this to the world every time they got into their car. And I grabbed my phone to take a picture of it, and I did take a picture of it, but the car had gotten a little too far out in front of me, so by the time I was able to blow it up, I couldn't see it, because I wanted to put it on Facebook and just say, add your own caption to this and see what people would say about it. I was just shocked. Now I understand there's times we feel really good about ourselves. We have good days, right? We might accomplish something that we've been waiting to accomplish for a long time, or maybe our kids have done something really great and outrageous, or maybe we've hit a home run on that project at work. But to go around every time you get in the car and announce to the world that you are great, I think takes it a step way too far. I mean, that's a lot of pressure you're putting on yourself. And God forbid you ever get into an accident that's your own fault. What are you going to say to the cop as he's writing down your plate? I guess you weren't that great this time, were you? And I did go out before the service and check in the parking lot just to make sure that there's nobody here who had that license. I think what really disturbed me about this as I was driving here the rest of the way was when I thought about it, I realized that this was probably not the only person that thought about ever having that plate. And I think there were probably, and probably still are, a lot of people who apply for that plate and are very disappointed to find that somebody had beaten them to it. In the gospel lesson today, we pick up Jesus' ministry as he arrives at Jerusalem not long before he's going to go to the cross on Good Friday. He has just cleared the temple of all the money changers, and now he's sitting in the temple teaching and preaching about the kingdom of heaven. The religious leaders of the day, of the temple, the authority and the power of his time, they're a little perplexed and indeed upset about the fact that he's doing this. So they come up to him and they ask, by what authority? Where do you get off, Jesus? Who do you think you are in taking our place, in doing this our job? They were really upset because he was usurping their authority and their power and their influence among the people. And I think at the heart of the issue with them were the fact that they thought that they were great. So as they confront Jesus realizes what's going on in his infinite and divine wisdom as our Creator and our Savior, and so he asks them a question to turn the tables on them. And they quickly come to realize that if they answer the question honestly, the people are going to come to see their hypocrisy, their corruption, and what's truly in their hearts. So they don't answer the question. Then Jesus tells the story of the two sons. The one son who says, no, I'm not going to do it, and then changes his mind and comes back, he's the one that represents what the kingdom of heaven is all about. What the power and the authority of the kingdom of heaven are all about. That even when you get it wrong in the first place, you can change your mind, you can come back and do what God has called you to do. The son, though, who says, yes, I'll go, and never goes, is an implication of what's in the hearts of those authorities, that power, those religious leaders that are confronting Jesus at that time. And I think that this story gives us some comfort, or maybe it disturbs us a little bit. Because what we come to see is, as much as we feel like the world has evolved and the world has changed and gotten better and more sophisticated, we come to see that those problems with power and authority that we have today existed just as much back at the time of Jesus. That those in power, those in authority, often pay lip service to what's really right and what they're going to do, but they don't really do it. We've had a change in power here in America over the last year, right? And we were told that things are going to be different this time. It's going to be a completely different approach to things, but it hasn't taken long for us to see that the same type of issues, the same type of hypocrisy, the same type of abuses are taking place, right? And then in the midst of that, we have all this passion going on different sides of all types of arguments. And what's ironic about it is that people are so passionate with their point of view because they think that they're right, right? And that comes from the same motivation, the same desire in the heart that leads people to put a license plate on their car that says, I'm great. It's my point of view, I'm right, I'm first. I'm gonna be the one to get this the way it needs to be. And yet, what's interesting is so often in the midst of that passion and the arguments on both sides, whatever side of the issue you're on, we see that what often one side accuses the other side of as far as their behavior being inappropriate or abominable, that the other side does the same exact thing when the tables are turned. Most recently this past week, we've had all this controversy about the National Football League, right? And both sides think they're right. The protesters think they're right because they're standing up for a cause. The people standing up for the flag and for the national anthem, they think they're right because they're protecting that. But what's lost in all of this noise is the real issue that started all this in the first place, and everything's gotten out of touch and gotten out of focus. In our epistle lesson today, St. Paul is talking to us about Jesus' journey into the cross and what it means for us as we live as the people of God. And as he talks to us, he gives us some very powerful and important words that we need to remember each day. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Having the mind of Christ doesn't mean walking around the world and having the attitude, I'm great. It's asking yourself what you can do to make others better, to make the world great, the world better. Having the mind of Christ doesn't look to the powers and the authority of this world for greatness or what we need. Having the mind of Christ means looking to the kingdom of heaven. And having the mind of Christ means understanding that greatness is not found in ourselves, but it's found in sacrifice. And the example of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross and what he's done for the world is the ultimate sign of greatness. Having the mind of Christ realizes that we're not great, but we are made great because of what Jesus has done for us. We're clearly now in the change of seasons. We're moving to the fall. And the fall often ushers in and invites a time of harvest. Lots of cultures and people have great harvest celebrations to remember the blessings that the earth brings forward, to celebrate the gifts that God gives to us. We are moving very quickly. Before you know it, our National Day of Thanksgiving will be here. And all these provide for us an opportunity to take stock and inventory. We do it also in the church at this time of year. We move into this season where we talk about what we call stewardship. What do we do with the gifts that God gives to us? How do we respond to the love that God gives to us? And every year around this time of year, we talk about numbers and the budget and the things of the church. How do we do the things that we need to do in this church to be this light in the darkness of the world, to be a symbol of hope in this community? And don't worry, we're going to do that again in the next few weeks, the next few months. But this year, we're going to do something even more important and different. As we look at our harvest, as we take stock of who we are as the people of God, this year we're going to take a look at how we can individually do what Paul encouraged us to do today. Let each of you not look to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Today we kick off what we're going to call Stephen Ministry. If you remember, Stephen was one of the first deacons that was called by the apostles in the early church. It didn't take long after Jesus' resurrection and ascension for the apostles to realize that as they went around and served the people of God in the gifts of word and sacrament, that there were so many other needs that the people of God had that needed to be taken care of. So as they took care of the spiritual matters, they called these first deacons to take care of compassionate ministry, care ministry, helping people in the time of loss, holding hands in the time of crisis, uplifting people when they're hungry and poor and struggling. And so those first deacons became a part of the church. Stephen in particular is the most well-known because Stephen was put to death, martyred, because of his service to others as a deacon. Well, just like in the early church, there are so many needs of God's people to be taken care of. We realize in the church today that there are many other needs that the people of God have that can't always be taken care of by the pastors, those ministers of word and sacrament. I've come to notice in my ministry as a pastor over 20 years, I've been astonished and amazed at how much it has changed in the way I do my job. 15, 20 years ago as a pastor, it would be no problem, an issue for me just about every single afternoon getting out of my office and getting out to visit people and help people and hold hands and be with them in their time of need. I would often find that after we had a funeral or a crisis type of thing like that, that it wouldn't be that challenging or difficult for me to get back to those people and follow up and see how they're doing. But things have changed so much today as far as administrative matters, as far as one crisis following another crisis, that I don't always have that opportunity to get out and be there and minister to people the way I want to or those people need to be ministered to. And so seeing that need, there's a call for us as we've experienced the love and the forgiveness and the grace of God to be empowered to do that for one another. So we're kicking off what this Stephen ministry journey. And over the next several months, you're going to hear a lot about this. Stephen ministry started over 40 years ago. And today there are over 12,000 churches among over 170 different Christian denominations all over the world that have Stephen ministers. And during that time, over 1.5 million people have been ministered to by these servants, fellow people of God, church workers, people that are here in the pews, helping them in their time of need, showing them compassion, giving them care in their time of struggle and trial. So over these next weeks and months, as we speak more about this, as you hear more about this, you will have the opportunity to prayerfully consider the invitation to become a Stephen minister. And this won't be a simple task. It'll require over 50 hours of training, classroom time, and working together in dialogue to learn what's appropriate and what's inappropriate in dealing with people's needs and issues. And it will call for you to make a commitment of your time, not expecting much in return other than the opportunity to help somebody else. But if you receive that calling from God and you accept that calling from God, you will be doing exactly what makes the kingdom of heaven different from all the power and the authority of the world. You will be doing exactly what St. Paul says we are to do as the people of God. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Amen.